Alamance County is pleased to present the Alamance County Commissioners Meeting.
The growth and prioritize the needs for Alamance County. We look to you for that support, and as always, we're grateful for the guidance that you provide. Continue to bless our troops that are overseas, serving and preserving the freedom and liberty that we have. We ask these things in your name. Amen. Amen. Please stand with me. We'll recite the pledge together. Please recite with me.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. And now we'll call the second meeting of May 2012, the Alamance County Commissioners Board together. I'd like to welcome everyone tonight. We will begin our meeting with the approval of the agenda. Commissioners, you have the agenda in front of you. We do have one item that was submitted after the agenda went out. It has to do with the request for a pyrotechnic display to be held at Ace Speedway, which is on Altamaha Racetrack Road in Elon, to be held on May 26, 2012. And this request comes from Dave Leonard in the Fire Marshal's office. If there is no objection, I would suggest that we add this item to the consent agenda. But please review the consent agenda. If there are any other items, including this one, that you would like removed from the consent agenda, we can certainly do that as well. If you'll take a minute and review the agenda, we'll make a motion following any request to remove consent agenda items. This will also serve to approve the minutes from our last meeting. Are there any items that we wish to remove from consent?
I'm good with
it. Hearing none, have a motion to accept the agenda, including the consent agenda.
I will move that we do that.
Thank you, Eddie. Is there a second?
Second.
Tori, I'll let you choose. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Thank you. We now have the public comment period, and we have three requests for public comment. First one is Mr. Bradshaw, who lives in Elon, would like to talk about the current budget and taxes. Mr. Bradshaw, please come forward. Welcome.
This is the first time I've been to a county commissioner's meeting, but I keep up with you in the paper.
Well, we welcome you.
But it's two subjects that has got under my skin the last couple of months, and that is, I know you got to raise taxes in order to get the county out of this hole, but why can we not look at sales tax where everybody pays it and not just keep putting the burdens on property tax people? Now, I know you've talked about putting it, a sales tax on the referendum and using it for draw industries into the county. To me, that money's better spent, if it's any way possible, to make a sales tax and go back into the general fund for y'all to spend and keep things correct. Because you keep putting the burden on people that owns property, I'm getting at the age I had just soon sell everything out and rent an apartment and not pay no taxes. It would save me around $900 to $1,000 a year. And people living in the city, they paying double taxes, so you put more of a burden on them. The next thing is this school system sitting on $21 million. And I've clipped articles out of the paper as Brad saying that they've been good stewards of the money. How can they be good stewards and to come out with a list of stuff this long that needs improvements, and they've collected tax dollars, they have collected monies from the lottery, and now they come up and to let people didn't know it, they still got bond money left over from 2004. It is ridiculous. Have y'all read the paper where this woman was collected, won a $1 million lottery and still collecting Social Security? That's a comic. The school board has become a laughingstock, in my opinion. They keep asking for money, and they said in the paper, if they don't get what they want, they're going to be forced to lay off employees. I say to Terry Johnson, if y'all continue to let these people build money, any money that man collects, he puts in a bank account and makes a rainy day fund for the sheriff's department. And then that way he don't ask y'all for cars. I mean, what's good for the goose is good for the gander. And it is not right that they say they're stewards of money. You go to these schools, you go to Williams High School, to some of these programs, and I've been there three times this week in the last couple of weeks, you got to park half a mile away and walk to some of the events at night, even with a football game. And they probably got, what, a couple acres in front of the school? That they could put a parking lot there with some of this money. I'm asking y'all to crack down on these people that wants to suck the county dry and put it in a bank account and then want to write in the paper that they good stewards of our money. I don't think it's right. And a lot of other taxpayers don't either. Thank you for your time.
Thank you,
Mr. Bradshaw. Mm-hmm. And we hope you come to many more commissioner meetings.
I will.
And school board meetings. That's right, Ms. Massey. Next on the list, without a subject, is Ms. Margaret Dameron. Would you wish to speak tonight?
Yes.
Please come forward.
I'd like to second that man's motion.
Would you like to come forward? Welcome to you.
I make mine short and sweet. I just want to second that man's motion. I go along with everything he said. That was my comment.
Thank you, Ms. Dameron.
There you go. Paige, you put your name down, didn't it, Mark?
Our third speaker, Mr. Eddie Shue, and the subject matter for comment, quote, is rant. Mr. Shue, you have 3 minutes to rant and rave if you'd like. We welcome you.
Good evening, Mr. Chairman. I'm going to save my comment for taxes to public hearing, as I was at the work session and pretty well know what's going on here. What I like to bring up, and this is going to go like a ton of bricks, I reckon, is this ACC bond issue. I got a daughter starting ACC next year. I say let her pay her own way. We'll help her if we can. Don't put it on the taxpayers. I know that it would have to pass a vote, but then that got to be paid for somewhere down the road. It don't come free. It's time that we stop the future increases so we don't get in this situation of y'all saying 2 cents, 2.5 cents, 4 cents, and what. If you don't spend it, you don't have to pay it back. Now, like the commissioner told me just moments ago, I'm all for people improving themselves. But themselves, if you want to go, you get the money, and you go. Why? We fund regular colleges, the state system. We fund high schools, and now they want more funding for the community college. I mean, where does it stop? We're nice people. We want people to help people. But we done about helped them. I mean, really, what are they saying, $15 million, I think, the figure I heard. It looks like it's had another tax raise down the road to me. And so, somehow, I'd like to see politicians start saying no, because I'll probably be out of office or moved on to greener fields by the time that issue comes up and we have to pay for it. And that's basically all I want to say.
Thank you, Eddie.
We have someone else who'd like to sign up.
Okay. Come forward, Jennifer. Welcome.
Thank you very much, commissioners. I know all of you very well over the years, and I don't try to come to too many of these. I have a lot of other meetings that I go to as well. But I have a lot of respect for the staff here, and I know them very well. They've always been great to deal with, but I pay over $60,000 a year in property taxes. That does not mean by any means that I am rich or wealthy. The bank owns everything. All I am is a collection agency for the bank. And, you know, with Tom knows this, I know from working with banks, and Bill, I'm sure you do too. The FDIC is down our throats, and every day when we, you know, I had 14 renewals between January and March, and they want to look at every single property and make sure that that individual property cash flows, regardless of whether you have, you know, $300,000 sitting at the bank. They don't care. They're looking at this specific loan and seeing where this specific loan is going to be renewed or not. And, you know, the money has, the numbers have to work. It's not, I can say, well, you know, I make money over here, or I make money over here. It doesn't matter. That particular property can only rent for a specific amount of money. And rents obviously have not gone up over the last, you know, 5 years. They've remained the same, luckily, but they haven't gone up. And when you've got loan officers that are charging you now, you know, I've never taken cash out of anything I've ever owned. I used to get renewals done for $50 a renewal. I'd go do 14 renewals. Now every renewal is $250 a renewal. Where does that money? That's money that's just flittered away. That's just bank fees now have gone from $50 to $250. Taxes have gone up. Insurance has gone up in this area for some reason as a result of these claims, these bogus claims on the foreclosures and things, 25%. So you're out searching for how can I combine properties together under single. I mean, it seems like it's a whole nother full-time job for me to do nothing but financing with these banks. And the money, it's a real simple mathematical equation. It's rents coming in, which is a fixed thing. It cannot change. Those rents coming in minus your taxes, minus what you pay in interest. You don't even get to deduct off your principal, your taxes, your insurance, and your expenses, and that bottom number has to service a debt ratio of 1.25. You just keep raising the taxes. I mean, it's absolutely positive that I'm going to be looking to sell what I can, even in a down market, because you have to make the numbers work. It's not like whether I make a dime of money. I could lose money every single year, but I'm still going to owe that $60,000 tax bill. And it just, you know, I talked to Tom, and I've talked to some of you guys, you know, outside of the meeting today, because when someone told me that you were thinking about raising taxes in this economy, I really honestly couldn't believe it, because I think the world of all of you and Mr. Honeycutt as well, and his staff. I just think it's so easy to get to a point where you go, you know, I don't want to cut here, I don't want to cut here. I just want to, you know, get this thing balanced and get to my next project. And it's so easy to just go to the taxpayer or pay the difference.
Thank you, Jennifer. We need to go on.
Just 3 minutes.
Oh, okay. Okay.
Thank you
so much.
Thank you.
That concludes the public comment section. Now we have time for commissioner responses to the public comments or to anything else at this time.
In regards to the sales tax, I think that's a great idea, but wouldn't each sales tax have to be on the ballot, theoretically?
Yes, sir.
Okay. No matter what it's for.
Right. If you put the quarter cent on the ballot, it you can state that you want to put that towards a source, mm-hmm. you know, to pay off debt service for schools or whatever. The last time we did it, we just stated it was for general fund, and it got defeated, I think.
It got defeated up here 3-2 vote, right. So I don't, when it went to the public, it got defeated there also. Right.
But it's always an option.
Mm-hmm.
Can't hurt.
Other commissioner comments?
Well, I to what his statement is, we did try that 2 years ago exactly. We put it on the ballot, and there was 3 that voted for it, 2 that voted against.
And I voted against it,
and
like all of Texas.
And I agree with you, sir. It would have been nice if we could have got that and got the public to bought into it, but they didn't. And so, therefore, you don't share the load with everybody.
Well, part of the issue that night, and the reason I opposed it, was you weren't willing to amend your motion to roll back property taxes the amount the sales tax would bring in.
Because we were already in the hole back then, Mr. Sutton, and, and now we look back, I'm not going to push that up because looking back, we were in the hole, and that's part of where we're at today.
But I would have supported it had it had you agreed to roll property tax back the amount that sales tax would have brought in, and it would have been a wash, and then bill from there.
We just missed our mark.
Just for the sake of information, that's why I offer that.
Thank you, Tim.
My philosophy on taxes is if you keep the money away from the governments, it won't be spent. And the taxpayers can spend it a lot better for themselves more so than the government can.
That's right, the economy
is going to get better with private expansion, not government expansion. The government only creates taxes. They don't produce taxes or money.
Thank you, Bill.
Anxious to get into this.
Let's move on then to items, actually what would be 6 and then into 7. Mr. Honeycutt, if you would like to begin the discussion or update us on the fiscal year 2012-13 manager's recommended budget, continue the presentation, and then conclude that with a request to schedule actually a budget hearing.
Okay.
Good evening.
Thank you. And are we going to pull?
We can.
Yeah, we'll go ahead and pull up the spreadsheet if the board would like to, the one that
just
we worked
the one we
on.
Saw before.
Yes,
sure.
Sir.
I think that'd be good.
If there needs to be looking at different options. But in front of you, we presented to you the manager's recommended budget for the 2012-2013 fiscal year. Again, this is manager's recommended. This is not board approved, and the board can change this as they so desire. The primary focus of this budget was really to look at maintaining services without using fund balance. And if with the board's discussions through our April meeting and through our workshops, with our unstable national economy, we're fully aware of that. The issue we basically have to look at on the revenue side is really threefold. In the manager's recommended budget, we're looking at a recommendation of a 2.5 cent tax increase. And again, why we're looking at 2.5 cents is threefold. Number one is the revenue neutral issue. When we set the tax rate back in the 2009-2010 budget, we set it at what we thought was revenue neutral. It ended up that we had 18,000 appeals on property valuations from the valuation. And that lowered our values greatly by really about 2.5 cents. The other issue that with respect to revenue is the loss of revenue that we've had from our sales and services, basically jail and EMS and other type sales and services. That loss of revenue in the 2012-13 fiscal year alone is $4 million. So we have to make up that balance somewhere. Again, the shortfall for revenue neutral is about $2.5 million. But also, we're not using fund balance. And again, we've used between $2 and $4 million for a fund balance on the last 3 years. We've had the flexibility to use fund balance. Our revenue projections have not met, but we've been okay because we've had a fund balance, and now we're at the point where we can't use fund balance anymore. And in this coming year, that is a goal of staff and a goal of this board is not to use fund balance. So that is why we're recommending the 2.5 cent tax increase. Again, we are looking at in discussions with the commissioners, a proposed 2% increase for employees. We're looking at a proposed 6% cut to outside agencies and 2% COLA and a 2% tax increase and a 2% cut to internal agencies or internal departments. But again, this is manager's recommended. The final budget that will be approved is board recommended and board approved. So. This is a good place for us to start. If there's been any suggestions or ideas or directions you would like me to look at to submit to you for our budget public hearing, which we're looking at right now for June 4th, we can go from there.
On the screen, Susan, are you controlling that over there?
Mm-hmm.
Is there a way that, and I saw you shrink it a second ago, can you shrink it to where we can see the columns, the names on the left-hand side, all the way over to that last, I don't think we need to see the four variables. We've talked about them and could look at them momentarily, but I think it would be good to see
what the polls.
I think where you're going now. Can you go back to the top of that? Okay, and just for the benefit of the folks that are viewing this for the first time, what we've proposed here is the county departments are listed first. Those are the ones that have department heads that report directly either to or through someone to Craig Honeycutt, and then you see the proposed budget there. Most of those show a 2% reduction in the operating cost or operating budget within the department, but with the employees within the department receiving a 2% cost of living adjustment.
And Mr. Chairman, if I could also say it's the question may be why is the internal departments only looking at 2%? If you do remember, we cut internally 3% last October, and this cut is based upon that 3% cut. So that's, you know,
additional
from where we were at the beginning of last year. And then last year we budgeted actuals that were based upon a 2% cut the year before.
So with the exception of the elections board, and there was one or two others that really we felt could not be slashed anymore given what's going to happen next year. Like I said, the election particularly right. is a good example. The departments you see listed, the proposed budget is a 2% reduction in operating right. costs adjusted back for the employees receiving a 2% cost of living adjustment.
Yes, sir.
Okay, Susan, if you'll slowly scroll down just to show those are all the departments in the county.
Right.
And then we get down to the next sub topic there, heading, the county funded agencies. These are agencies not directly reporting to the county, but receive county money. And you see there who receives the most money, the school system, community college, PBH, which is the former local management entity from Mental Health Administration. All of those numbers you see represent a 6% reduction from the amount they received during, or they will have received during the current fiscal year, which ends June 30th. So you can see the cuts.
Right.
And that last line, I know we truncated it. We're not cutting the school system,
right.
for instance,
right.
$36 million. That is the amount right. they would be receiving.
Yes, sir.
So is that, Susan, can we go down below that? And I think there's a, the restricted county departments represent either money that's passed through from federal and state sources such as grants. And then we also have in there somewhere the amount of interest that we're paying on right. on our debt. But that's not really money that is controllable within this group. It totals about $35 million. And then down at the bottom, there should be a total where, based on Mr. Honeycutt's budget, the additional, the total net difference with the 2.5% increase would be a plus $170,000.
Right.
That does include, and it's important to note, the contingency under line item 86, $636,000 does represent a contingency item that, if not used, would be used to replenish the fund balance. I think we all need to be aware that that level of a little over 9% now is dangerously low to what we're required to keep, which is the minimum of 8%.
Yes, sir.
So that's the format that we reviewed at our work session. Now, Susan, if you go back up on the upper right, the variables that can change that the most dramatic would be a change in the percentage to the department reductions of 2%, outside agencies of 6%, cost of living adjustment for Alamance County employees of 2%, with the plug, if you will, being the 2.5 cent tax rate, which is tax rate increase, which is what's reflected in the manager's budget. And that's where we left it last Wednesday.
Is that 6% already taken out of the outside agencies?
Yes, ma'am.
That's showing up.
Yes, ma'am. That's, right that's shown in the figures. Yes, okay. Ma'am.
And all the others is
yes,
well.
Ma'am.
Okay.
Does that also include the where we phase back the discount on taxes?
Yes, sir. It
that,
does.
That's included.
That's already included. Yes,
all right,
sir.
And that's a $500,000.
Yes, sir.
And we had a discussion. Bill mentioned the employee match. Have you come up with any numbers?
We have. Let me get my book here. We had a discussion on 401k at our budget last meeting. The way it's broken down is we currently budget $847,000 in 401k funding. However, law enforcement is mandatory that we put 5% aside. So that is $274,000 that we're obligated under statute for law enforcement officers. Again, so that means all other departments, non-mandatory, is about $570,000. The discussion was, could we look at requiring, there? Right now there is no require for match for 401k. Some people do match, some employees match, some employees don't match. The discussion I think Commissioner Lashley brought up was, most private companies require a match for 401k.
Right.
And if we required a match, would there be any savings? And what we looked at, that we found that there's almost $250,000. And again, I think the numbers may vary a little bit, but there's about $250,000 mm-hmm. that employees put into the 401k savings. Some put more. Some put less, but it's around the $250,000 mark. There's a potential savings there of around $300,000. The recommendation would be to budget fully the 401k this year and see what employees may or may not, you know, because we've not gone out and asked every employee. If you had the opportunity to lose that funding, would you match?
Would you know, start contributing?
So we just haven't had enough time yet.
Well, we can still do it. They can either do it or not.
That's what he's saying.
If they put their 2%, we'll match it with 2%.
Yep, and I think if the board would like, we can do that as a policy change as of July 1. The recommendation probably be still budget fully like we did this year, just because not sure who will put in or not. The savings from that we could put back to fund balance.
Sure.
So, but we can do that.
That's acceptable. Yeah.
Yes, sir.
Do you know of the employees?
Percentage-wise.
Not the law enforcement folks. Now, are they having to contribute under the terms?
No, sir.
So they don't.
Not under statute.
So we just matched theirs when we adopted one for the whole county.
Right.
But basically.
Right.
And what is the maximum we put in per employee?
2% for our employee. Well, the sheriff's department's our employees, but it's mandatory 5%.
For
law enforcement.
State mandate.
But 2% is what we're talking about.
Yes, sir.
So one way would be to look and see who's not participating at all now, because mm-hmm. you have some employees that do
right.
that do
we
go
do.
Ahead.
Yes, sir.
And that wouldn't change.
Right. And I guess, you know, that's when we would have to get back with employees and say, you know, they may look at contributing if they knew that they were going to lose
right.
that yeah. funding.
So what this number you're coming up, you've kind of done a preliminary to see the participation level. Ooh. And you're looking at possible
maybe
savings
about
from that.
300.
But that's not reflected in these numbers.
No, sir, it's not. But again, it would be hopefully reflected, you know, depending upon who participated or not at year end next year. So we would have a better handle.
As long as yeah. I'd like to make that a motion as that be our county policy that we match 2% if the employee pays 2%.
With the employee, to a max.
Only if they put 2% in.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Would it be like if they only put 1% in? Would the county
put 1%?
And I I appreciate what Bill's saying. I would like for Sherry's group to make sure to fine-tune that and bring it back.
And make so it as a presentation.
If this is the direction of the board, we can have you a written policy at our next meeting.
That meets all the legal requirements.
Yes, sir.
Right.
Yes, sir.
Then we can look at it and know where we are instead of voting on it tonight.
Yeah. But, okay. Bill, are you prepared to make that in a formal motion?
I am.
Is there a second?
Second.
Mm-hmm. Any other discussion about that part? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
You opposed? Sherry, does that meet your needs? Anything else on that subject? If we wanted to play with those variables, and Craig, stop me when I say something wrong, but a percent to the outside agency is around 400,000, I think is what you told me.
Yes.
So it's a little less than half a cent for each percent of the outside agencies.
Is that
385,000?
385,000.
So the cost of living increase, 1%. Well, it just lost.
That's sorry. She's plugging that 1% to tell you what it
1%
is.
1% reduction is 385.
Okay, so that's there a little less than half a cent.
Mm-hmm.
All right, so the employee raise of 2%, each percent is about 700,000?
400.
Oh, so it's less than half a cent also.
Right.
Yes.
Yeah.
Okay.
The total 2% is 799,000, okay. I
think. So about 400.
Yeah.
So you're looking at 7.
Okay, so I'm just trying to think if we were to do some different scenarios, if you took a half percent here and a half percent there, how that would affect the 2.5 tax rate increase if you want to keep the, for instance, replenishment or contingency fund, which I see is enhancing the fund balance. And I think that is something we need to consider. We don't want to risk that going down any further. But those are just the kind of the variables we're looking at if we wanted to alter the 2.5 tax rate based on your variables here.
Yes, sir.
Well, this needs to be out there for consideration. I brought up at the work session the longevity pay situation, and I'm not going to back off of that. Years ago, when I asked the question about longevity pay, the counties was under $500,000 and found out at the work session that it's approaching $1 million.
Is it 850?
It's 900,000.
900,000.
That's pretty close to $1 million. And I was shocked that it had doubled, especially after we said that we were going to raise the floor and then cap it. For the life of me, I don't understand how it doubled. There is a report on the, what's the group in Chapel Hill?
Institute of Government.
Institute of Government. If you pull that up, there's a chart of every county in the state about specifically longevity pay. There's, unless I miscounted, roughly 1/4 of the counties in the state, they don't have longevity.
Right.
Our immediate peers, Randolph, doesn't have it at all. Davidson's is half what ours is, and they have the same number of employees, roughly the same tax rate, and roughly the same budget. So roughly 1/4 of the state doesn't have it. And if you look at the comparisons of the intervals of where you get the 2, 3, 4, 5, 6%, I didn't do a scientific analysis on it, but just my rough look at it, we had the most lucrative longevity pay system in the state, as far as I was, just a quick look. So I think somehow this has got to be addressed as time goes on.
I think now's a good time to address
short
it.
Short or long. But
this is the time to address it. Budget time is a good time.
Well, I'm not, we might decide tonight. I'm not willing to decide tonight, but that information has got to be out there. No disrespect to county government or county employees, but the government employees should be better off than the private sector, in my opinion. And I don't care, you go out here on the streets and ask people, do you get longevity pay? do you get this, do you get that? I mean, I sat beside a guy at the library today, and he told me, he said, I hadn't had a raise in 5 years. He works for a pretty lucrative company in Burlington. Local newspaper had to take a 5 or 10% pay cut, furlough their employees. I mean, nobody likes any of this, but government can't be any different. Matter of fact, government should be equal, if not more, in the public servant arena versus you know what I'm trying to say, I hope. And I'm not trying to slap anybody, but you know, these, I was stunned to find out our longevity pay was approaching $1 million. That just shouldn't be.
How long has that been in?
Well, I know when I asked the question, I called even the city of Burlington. I mean, I've been up here a while. It could have been 10 years ago. I don't know. When was it? I don't remember the year.
Well, longevity actually started in 1991. And when it started, it was you had to be here 2 years to get 1%. And then it went on up to five years, and I think that was 2.5%, and so on. The only change that I could find in longevity happened in 2001, and that was where we said new employees wouldn't get longevity until 5 years of employment. And at that time, they'd been here 5 years, they'd get 2.5%. But nowhere could I find anything about a cap.
Oh, we talked about it clearly, I remember.
Because the percentages change, you know, as employees have been here longer, you move up into a different percentage. It's anywhere from 2.5% on up to 6% if you've been here 20 years. So it just varies from year to year. It did start out at 400,000, and then it's just kind of worked its way up.
I called the city of Burlington even, and ours was 400 and some, Burlington's was 400 and some. But if you look at that 100 chart, that 100 county chart, ours appears to be the most lucrative of any of the counties, basically, that I saw, especially our, right, what you would call your peer group. I mean, there's some major, very credible counties. They don't offer it. They don't pay it. And maybe they've got higher pay. I don't know. There's always
There's always variables. And I think also one reason for the increase is our employees are staying on longer as well, and especially in today's job market, people are hanging on longer. So they're not retiring as quickly as they have in the past.
Well, none of this is easy. I was watching Channel 11, which is the Raleigh station, at 6 o'clock right before I left to come over here, and they had their meeting today. And the numbers won't mean anything because their base is so much larger, but they're giving the school system over there an additional $4 million. They're giving law enforcement more money. They are giving their Wake County employees a 2% cost of living adjustment. And you know, the press will say, well, how can you do this? Nobody's unhappy with this. And the commissioner that was interviewed said, well, we were fortunate enough to increase our property tax base to generate an extra $22 million.
Plus a high tax rate.
We don't have, yeah, but I was talking about the difference. Mm-hmm. And there wasn't going to be a change in the tax rate this year.
They're already there.
They took care of that last year.
Well, they're sure enjoying it this year. We don't have that luxury. We have to manage winding down the revenue base, and that's what we're looking at. But at the same time, we've got to preserve our fund balance. And beyond that, there's our options.
And if throughout the next couple of weeks, we can run you any scenario that you would like. And if there's ideas that you have that we haven't thought of, please let us know. I do want to thank staff and Amy and Susan. We worked really hard to get us to this point. And like you said, there's a lot of hard decisions that are even in this budget. You know, again, We don't have new positions. You know, new positions were requested. We don't have new capital except for the Sheriff's Department, but that was cut by about $400,000. So, you know, the employees have not had raises since the 08-09 physical year. We've been band-aiding some things for the last 3 years to try to get through this economic downturn that we've had, but we've had the flexibility with fund balance, but again, the flexibility has left us.
Our fund balance, no matter if we don't touch it anymore, and you don't put any contingency in, what is it?
10.93
right now, and that was at the year end of June 30th last year. And again, we're thinking maybe using $2 million this year.
Don't we know?
Well, it depends upon revenue still coming in. You know, we still got sales and service revenue. We still have a lot of variables that come in.
What we're assuming is going to be the median hit. What will the percentage be at the end of this fiscal year?
About 9.
About 9%.
9, okay. What about the rest of the state? Not necessarily counties bigger than us, but, you know, there's like 14 counties, including us, that are our size, basically. Do we have a handle on what?
Average.
Yeah, roughly.
Most of them are between 15 and 24.
I think it was like about 15%.
15 and
24. Anywhere from 15 on up to 24%.
I know Davis is just out of sight, but what they did, they went through reevaluation, didn't cut property tax a penny, not even a penny.
Well,
remember when he told us that when we went down there, and I looked at him and I said, how'd you pull that off? They burned our courthouse down. He just laughed.
They
went through reevaluation and did not cut pennies, did not cut a penny off tax. And that's why they're fine. But see, their populace isn't as educated as ours is, in my opinion. Press doesn't cover as well as it should down there versus ours. But the public doesn't even understand it. We didn't raise your taxes at all. Oh, my tax bill's $500.
Well,
I understand this.
You know, we looked. That's talked about earlier.
We
if,
just got
you know,
smarter
we
tax
looked taxes. At our county to the east of us. You know that they were not having a tax increase as well, but their tax rate's 85 cents. So
already,
you know, and.
Well, you know, I like Tim's question. Yeah. Can we get that just as reference material?
Yes, sir.
Take the peer counties and look.
We've got it in our big book. We've
yeah, the tax rates are in the.
They all are in there.
Yes,
sir. On this thing.
Yes, sir.
That's right.
They're in the back of our
first book that we started out.
Well, procedurally, can we take what we have here and schedule a public hearing and hear what the public says before we make a. I'm not saying we are going to do this. I don't know. But
yes.
One of the options I'm asking is can we go to the public hearing with the information we have now?
Yes, sir. You have to have a manager's recommended budget presented to you with a proposed tax increase.
Right.
This is what this is. And we can go from that point.
Mr. Chair, I have a question. Okay, so we are saying that if we get to 8%, the state will take us over or whatever. What is the repercussion there?
The repercussions is the state will come in and kind of mandate that you do things as far as financially. They can come in and mandate that you raise taxes.
That's what I thought.
They can come in and mandate
now, that's exactly what I thought.
That you don't use fund balance. The only one I can think of this, they'll give you a couple of years. They're not going to take over,
mm-hmm.
but they will set you up a work plan to ensure that you're doing what you're supposed to do to build up your fund balance.
And they will tell us how much tax increase.
Well, I'm thinking of Harnett County. Is that the one recently that the state basically came in and said, you will not use fund balance, you will raise taxes, you know, or an offset of, you know, cuts, tax increase, no fund balance usage, but they get very specific about their requirements.
Well, I think a lot of people didn't understand what happens if
right.
we go to that 8 million mark, you know.
No, 8%.
8%.
Yeah.
I don't think we want the state coming in here and telling us.
No, and I don't either, and that's what I'm saying, you know, so, you know, it's just.
But
my frustration with that is, Susan, if you'll go down to those restricted funds one more time,
A lot of that money right there is pass-through money, and yet it's included in our total, and it's included when they calculate the fund balance requirement. And I don't think that's appropriate.
Quite fair.
At all. Because, again, the SAMHSA grant, for instance, that we've talked about, look at that. That's $1 million that we have to keep 8% of by law, even though it's strictly pass-through and we have nothing to do with it.
Well, and I think it's also important to realize if we look at the debt service number at $11 million, we've added about $2.6 million worth of new debt service in the last 3 years from our facilities improvements to the 800 megahertz. They were good projects to do because the money was at a low interest rate, and we have tried to absorb the increase in debt service payments. And we didn't raise taxes due to that increase in debt service either. So that's been above and beyond.
Well, I still think in the long term, the only way we're going to be able to increase funding for these different agencies is to increase our property tax base. And that means getting folks in here to live, to work, to have their businesses here.
Yes, sir.
And encourage whatever development we can.
Yes, sir.
That's the only thing long term that's going to fix all this.
Are there any additional questions? But again, if there's additional information you need, please don't hesitate to ask. We'll get what you need, and the board, if the board is agreeable, we can set our public hearing by motion for June 4th for the budget public hearing.
Based on the information and where we have discussed so far.
Yes, sir.
Tonight.
Yes, sir.
Just for point of information, I'm a hard head. I called Chapel Hill, and I'm pretty sure I asked that question about the 8%, and they didn't tell me we could come in there and raise your taxes. I like to get somebody, not that I want to go below it.
Yeah.
But I just want, for debate purposes, I want somebody to write it in a paragraph. Yes, we can do that, because I don't believe they can.
Okay. We'll get.
If there's a case with Harnett County,
I don't know anything about Harnett County.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying.
If it's there, let's hear it. Let's see it. Yeah. I just don't.
I think they will give you a letter of warning, and then you probably have to present to them your plan
of action
to build your fund balance.
That's what the guy told me when I called. But that's hardly.
But if you don't follow your plan, and if it continues to go. Yes, they can.
Well,
it's very, very rare.
I
it's very,
see
very
the
rare.
Reg and general statutes and the whole nine yards.
Yes, sir.
I don't want somebody just to tell
me. Well,
we
operate at the state's
Chihuahua County,
pleasure.
Right.
Whatever rules that they pass, we have to abide by. So,
well, the state versus school of government is two different things.
Right.
Well, I'm not talking about, I don't trust nothing the school of government tells me. I could care less what they say.
How to merge schools legally.
Tim just pointed me out one as well. Chihuahua County. Up in the northeastern part of the state basically came in, and I think they did mandate a tax increase.
The state or school of government?
State.
Okay. I still want to see the law that they operate under.
Yes, sir.
Under that.
Okay. Well, let's don't wait for the next meeting. Let's get that and send it out to everybody.
We can have that tomorrow.
Yeah, that's probably.
We can have that tomorrow.
I'll know more then than I know tonight. Yeah.
Yes, sir. Yeah. All right.
All right. Is there. He didn't ask for a motion. Is there a feeling?
Oh, yes.
That we continue our analysis, get input, and go ahead and schedule the public hearing for June 4th, which would be 2 weeks from now. I'm asking if there's a motion to schedule the public hearing and not take any action on the budget this evening. Is there such a motion?
I'll make that motion.
Okay. There's a motion by Bill. Tim, will you second that motion? A discussion on that motion.
I don't remember us ever voting for a budget. You know, I think every budget we've ever approved
was at that hearing.
It was a public hearing, except for one. And that was when I went up here at the courthouse and had 500 people up there. I'll never forget it. And standing room only in the back.
They had the ropes, five ropes all pulled over the banister.
Well, we first started over here, and then everybody, there wasn't enough seats, and they were lined up outside on the sidewalk.
Yeah.
We had choir groups, I remember that.
And then we ran up, and there was, people out there singing that we were going to do away with choir and choirs and stuff like that. And I think that night we If I'm not mistaken, we put it off till we had a work session, and then I think we approved it in a work session, if I'm not mistaken.
And I think you're right, Tim. I don't think even if we had gone down further, we would be approving the budget. We would be approving the recommended budget that the manager has to present at the public hearing.
Yeah. Right.
And that's what we're stopping
short of. Fire departments to.
Well, yeah, that's
separate. Right.
That's separate.
And we'll
can
make
you hold off on that a minute?
I'm sorry.
Because we've got, I have a question about that as well.
Okay, yes, sir.
But that's not part of the general operating budget.
No, sir.
Okay.
But they normally make that at this meeting.
Right, at the public hearing.
Right.
Yeah.
Okay. So Bill has agreed to offer the motion. Tim second. And any other discussion?
I'm good.
We need to repeat the motion?
Yes.
The motion is that we continue to study the scenarios presented to us by county staff and schedule the public hearing for June 4th. That's basically it, isn't it?
Yes, that's it.
And Tim seconded that motion. Right. Any other discussion? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Okay, thank you, Craig. Now, before you leave, talk just a minute about the fire districts, because you told us at the work session that two of the, it's in
what page?
Right.
Five.
Two of the fire districts have indicated that they are going to make presentations. Can you translate the increase to what that would mean for the people that live in those districts? I mean, what are we talking about? A penny?
Elon would be going up, the Elon Fire District would be going up a half cent. And Fawcett would be going up a half cent as well.
Okay. Didn't Fawcett get one last year? Didn't they get a 50% last year?
E.M. Holt did.
E.M. Holt got two last year.
Got how much?
Two cents. I think that's correct. They to buy some air packs. Right. We do need to talk about that, but we'll do that at the
Here's the question as well. We have normally not, unless you're not asking for an increase, we've not asked for the fire chiefs to come. Would you like us
I would
to specifically
like, I would
ask?
Because they went up 2 cents, they got the air packs, now I want to see them come back down too.
Okay, we will make sure that they're invited as well. If there's any other fire
at
chief.
At least tell me why they need it now.
Okay, if there's any other fire chief or fire department that you would like to make a presentation as well, please let me know. Okay.
You're saying that was for capital
for EM, huh?
They went.
Yeah.
Was,
yeah.
They went they up needed
7.75 to
right. They
9.
Went up for air packs. They got them. Turned around and sold theirs to another county, and now they back up.
Your proposed fee increases. That's also
yes, sir.
Part of the revenue budget.
Yes, sir.
And would be included
yes,
in
sir.
The public hearing.
Yes, sir.
If anybody that wanted to come and talk about fees, they could
yes,
do
sir.
That as well.
Yes, sir.
The public hearing that will be scheduled on June 4th, anyone can talk about any subject within the budget. It is pertaining to the budget. There is not a 3-minute limit, so if you've got a particular passion for an item, we certainly want to hear those comments.
Chairman Manning, I don't know if it's proper or not, but I'm assuming we'll have a lot of people probably come to that. Is that something we may consider moving the meeting for?
Well, we've had budget meetings where nobody showed up.
I know. I'm just, I don't know, but, you know, to make provisions anyhow.
Yeah. Well, the Williams High School, about 10 years ago. We met at Williams, met the courthouse. We've gone over there.
Over there where?
Well, in the district.
Next door.
Oh, yeah.
Mm-hmm. I mean, is that something we could make provision that away?
Well, if the board does decide that, we do need to decide that now so we can put that in the ad, because the address needs to be in the ad.
Well, what's the closest, largest place to where we are right here?
Probably the historic
courthouse.
Courtroom.
Can we do that?
Yes, sir.
Yeah.
Just for a temporary meeting?
Yes, sir. Mm-hmm.
But we need to do it. What
right.
you're saying, we need to make a motion to do
that.
Oh,
no, I understand that. But, right. you know, when we talked about moving our meetings, there was a lot of expense. And
it was.
But for a temporary
right.
meeting.
Temporary is not a problem.
Right.
And we won't sacrifice the sound and the ability for people to hear and speak.
Yes, sir.
Yes, we won't.
No, yes, sir. We'll be fine. We'll be fine. It will. I'm sorry. I apologize.
You'll make it work. Right?
Well, it will not be the quality that you get here,
right.
but it will still be good enough quality.
Well, and I would encourage everybody to come to that meeting, because that's a big deal.
That's a big meeting, and I think we don't want to discourage people.
All right, well, you brought it up. You make that motion.
I will make that into a motion that we go to the old historic courthouse and enjoy some of the beautiful surroundings we spent money on.
For a second, Seal, any other discussion? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed?
Okay, thank you.
Craig, thank you. And that took care of items 6 and 7. And thanks to all the commissioners for their review. Thanks, as Craig said, to all the staff, Amy, Susan, Tim, all of y'all that are putting this together. It's not easy, and frankly, it's not fun right now. But we have what we have. Okay. Item 8 is the Alamance Community College Board of Trustees bond request for the Advanced Applied Technology Center. Dr. Martin Nadelman, president of the community college, and also Carl Steinbecker, who I believe is chair of the trustees this year. Welcome. Come forward.
Thank you. Thanks for the opportunity to come in front of you tonight. We've got some items that we think are important to the community and wanted to address those to you. The initial plan for an advanced applied technology building came from the college's 10-year facility master plan in 2008. The plan was developed by local architectural firm Alley Williams Carman and King. The advanced applied technology building was designated as our priority building project later in 2008. The state legislature provided initial funding in 2009 to develop the schematic drawings for a proposed facility. The college hired the architectural firm of Mosley Architects to meet with the college administration and also the program department heads to design a building to house automotive technology, welding technology, machine technology, carpentry, heating, air conditioning, and ventilation programs. The advanced applied technology building design is for 62,000 square feet with classrooms, common computer lab, classrooms for continuing education, and individual areas for each program skill workshops. Major facility changes and building expansion projects are a coordinated activity between the college and the trustees. The trustees have final approval for major facility changes at the college. There are trustee committees that are responsible for overseeing major functional areas at the college. One of the trustee committees is the Building and Grounds Committee. The current Building and Grounds Committee consists of Dr. Reed Dusenberry, who is our chair, Doug Fincannon, and Russell Wilson. This committee is responsible for making assessments and recommendations to the team. The Building and Grounds Committee has looked at 5 facilities in Alamance County, Lucent Technology Building, the BOV, 2 automobile facilities, and Flint Knit. And the college has spent close to $15,000 assessing several of these. The takeaway from the facility visits is that there are no inherent advantages for using these facilities, and after a remodel, the college will be left with a 35 to 40 year old building. The long-term costs are expected to be more favorable for a new LEEDS certified facility versus the facilities that we visited. Approximately 1 year ago, the county commissioners were invited to tour the college and view the current areas that house welding, automotive, carpentry, and the heating and air conditioning. The current areas are cramped, they do not allow for growth, and are not conducive to good teaching. And I mean, those of you that were there during the visit, I mean, you had difficulty in just hearing the classwork that needed to be done because of noise made by other groups. The county commissioners asked the college to postpone a request for a referendum in 2011 in the fall and to re-propose that in the fall of 2012. The college trustees are requesting a referendum be placed on the November ballot for a $15 million bond to support an advanced applied technology facility. The project is 1 cent or less per $100 valuation. The first major expense would not be anticipated until the fourth quarter of 2013. This facility, if approved, will permit expanded enrollment opportunities for automotive, welding, machining, carpentry, and HVAC with modern, up-to-date equipment necessary to produce well-trained graduates. If placed on the ballot for November and approved by voters, the building would likely be completed for the fall semester of 2014. In conclusion, ACC plays a critical role in this community. The wave of the future is for educated and trained employees. The number of transfer students continues to increase at ACC due to the financial cost to go to a four-year school. I, again, from a standpoint of being a chair and a trustee, it's difficult to hear all the things that are being said here this evening, but believe me, the trustees and in my heart are in the fact of wanting to grow the economic base here in this community, and ACC is at the heart of that. I just attended a graduation last week where we had a 77-year-old gentleman who graduated with his GED, and there were over 100 GED graduates. And again, that's part of just a small part of what ACC does for the community. And we are very much in need of trying to step up, compete with the other schools, and have programs that we're going to feel that are going to give us the economic momentum that we need to continue to move forward. Thank you.
Dr. Hammond?
Mr. Steinbecker said it all. I think what I would say is this building is going to take the college back to its roots, vocational technical programming. The building they're currently in is almost 30 years old.
No, the mic.
Oh.
Somebody coming up behind my back. And we need to make sure that we have the equipment and the area that these people need to be able to become good skilled workers. These aren't jobs that are going to go away. You know, your auto mechanic's not going to disappear. The guy that repairs your heating and air conditioning is going to be around. Sandvik will tell you they need every welder we can give them, and machinists. So we are packed right now. Automotive is full, welding is full, machining is full. Those are three programs that we're actually having to tell people, I'm sorry, we don't have classroom space for you during the day. We've gone to evening, we filled those, and now we're on afternoons and we're on weekends. We feel that this will get the college where it needs to go, and we would like for you to consider putting it on the ballot. And we will be good stewards of the money.
And what you didn't say was in our tour when we were in the automotive area, I was surprised that the plants and the horticulture could breathe from the emissions from the autos that y'all were working on, not to mention the safety factor of having everybody pile on everybody.
Well,
no question that the space is.
Yeah, when two students are working in automotive, they happen to be on the opposite sides of the car from each other, they're touching each other. There's no question about it.
Well, and also, too, you know, where they do the building, you know, and they can't even stand the boards up in the classroom, in the carpentry section. So I understand where you're coming from.
I think tonight, Craig, my understanding, we are going to receive this request and allow county staff to do a little analysis and massaging about how what our options would be in terms of putting it on the ballot, and we can consider it at maybe the next meeting.
Yes,
or
sir.
Certain to get it on the ballot,
right,
we have to have a 90-day notice, is that right?
Right.
Which would be sometime in the summer.
Yes, sir.
Not that we need
right.
or want to wait that long, but
right.
but basically it'll give your staff time to request whatever additional
right.
background information
okay.
that you may want to see, and then address it with the board.
Yes, sir.
At either the next meeting or the following. Does that make sense?
Yes, sir. We can do it.
Is that the plan?
Does it have to be a property tax, or can it not be a sales tax option?
it can be a sales tax option.
That's what I thought. You know, down in Randolph County, they had a, I was shocked to see, they had like 2 to 3 local option sales taxes approved. And one of them was for the community college. And, you know, where they raised the heck down there, looks like here about property tax, you know, they supported their community college with the sales tax. So, you know, I don't know how y'all, have y'all discussed that as far as what you would prefer?
We have.
All right, what's your opinion?
The board feels very strongly that the bond referendum is the better way for us to go.
Well, that's not what I'm talking about. Property tax versus sales tax.
You're saying so vote for the bond referendum with a sales tax
right.
being the
versus instead of a property tax
being the vehicle to pay for that bond.
Yeah, we had discussed that, and part of the discussion was because of the economic climate, would it be more favorable to be supported through a bond versus a sales tax? And I think, you know, on the surface, Mr. Sutton, a lot of times I think it's perceived that the sales tax might be a little bit more negative versus a bond that they know that is kind of a fixed thing and will eventually end. And so the trustees did discuss that and felt that, you know, we put that in the referendum proposal to look at it as a bond proposal.
For property.
Yes.
But you could do the analysis for us and show the implications
right.
either way.
And again, that is a request, but this board could, if you so choose, you could make whatever option as far as as funding. And in all honesty, they're more worried about receiving the $15 million, and then this board has to worry about how to pay for it. So.
That's right.
Yeah.
But in the scenario that Tim's mentioned,
right.
either way, to the
right.
voters.
Right. It,
exactly.
Yeah. For that, what, right.
opportunity to vote on that with a
right.
option of a
right.
sales tax to be the funding source.
Right.
I would say that in 2000, when we did the bond referendum, we had 62% approval with a property tax increase. And in 2004, when we did it again, we had 67% approval for a property tax increase. Again, we're looking at less than a penny on the tax rate, and it will expire when the bonds are paid off. That will expire.
That don't mean the taxes are going to come down.
I didn't say that.
I'm not saying tax rates are.
You're absolutely right.
You're right. But again, our 2000
the payments stop, but the tax seem to never come on.
Right. Well, the 2000 bonds, I assume,
yeah.
are going to expire pretty soon. I don't know. It's like 15 years.
We can right. we'll get all that information.
Well, I think that is the
right.
kind of information that would be helpful.
Right.
Other questions for either Carl or Dr. Nadelman at this time? We thank you all for coming and
thank
for
you.
Presenting, and I do
definitely
appreciate the homework that you've done. As you said, Carl, a year ago, getting us into the process and inviting us down to the college, I think that made a big difference.
And I'd like just to comment. I appreciate you guys taking. And waiting to a general election to put this out there instead of pushing us to put it on a off-year election or whatever. I think the whole county needs an opportunity to vote on this and to buy in, because I think what you're doing is a definite needed thing for the county, because I've heard this fact, a guy from Sandvik told me when they came in here that you didn't have the facilities to train for some of the jobs, and they were going out of the state to bring people here to work at Salmon. And I think that's just a crying shame for our county not to have the opportunity to supply those workers.
They wanted a 5-axis machine. We're ready to teach it. I don't have floor space for
well, there you go.
Machine.
So that's the answer that we need to look to.
I
resolve.
Think that's what the technical schools are all about, is the technical educations. That's where I went and got mine, and it pays off.
I'm it's still paid. Going.
Thank you.
Next item on the agenda, item 9, Education System Collaboration to Increase the Educational Stability Grant Request. Susan Osborne, Director of DSS. Susan, are you here? Susan, you're not here.
Susan's not here. My name is Adrienne Day. I'm the Children's Services Program Manager with Department of Social Services. And I'm standing in for Susan this evening. But before you have a memo regarding a grant that we would like to apply for, and it's about our children who are in foster care ages 10 to 17, who are actually having very poor outcomes right now. So we're looking at improving their educational stability as well as their permanency outcomes. With that, we'll be looking at their social and emotional outcomes as well. This is a two-year infrastructure grant. The opportunity is from the Children's Bureau. It is $250,000 for a period of 2 years, and there's actually no match in this grant opportunity. So just want to know if you have any questions.
How much travel is there?
There is a requirement for two grantee meetings, and with that, in our proposal, we would write in that two members from Department of Social Services would actually attend that, because they're pretty specific about the project manager attending and also any personnel that's directly related to the grant.
This federal or state?
This is federal.
Okay, where is the travel?
It is Washington, D.C. Both meetings would be in Washington. Okay.
I'll make a motion that we approve this.
I'll second it.
Any other discussion? We have a motion and a second. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Thank you.
Thank you, Adrian.
Mr. Chair, if I could mention, the reason why Susan is not here tonight is her mother's been very ill, and Susan's been with her, so if we could keep Susan our thoughts and prayers.
Thank you, Greg. Do you have a manager's report?
I have one thing, or a couple of things I did want to mention. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. An update on Graham Manor from the city of Graham. We have had discussions with the mayor and also the city manager, and there is no interest from the city of Graham about purchasing the Graham Manor site.
Okay, I have a question to that. What are we going to do with that building?
Bulldoze it.
That's an option. There is an option maybe to ask for sealed bids, you know, and just to see if there's any interest.
I think, didn't you get some rough quotes from D.H. Griffin on the demolition?
Yeah, demolition. And actually did out the demolition project. We did get some estimates from them, and not including asbestos removal. I think it was somewhere, I think the range was maybe 140 to 170, 150. But that didn't include any asbestos removed. So I think the number Craig gave you last meeting was around $200,000. If we had to do all that, of course, we are getting another price from another company to see what they would come in at.
We could see that
come down some if we were bid out of demolition, so it might come down.
They've converted in Greensboro some schools that aren't quite as old as that one. They probably look a lot better, but still old in the condos. Apartments, and I gave you a name in Greensboro or Winston-Salem of somebody that did projects like that.
I did have a gentleman come in today with an interest in the possibility of putting apartments. I think if we
get rid of the school, like Tim said, bulldoze or get rid of it, and there may be some potential other interests. Like you say,
before
condos.
We spend the bulldozer to see if that guy wants to turn into condos.
There you go.
That's right.
Well, the problem is I don't think he wants what we have, unfortunately.
We can ask him.
Be nice.
They just turned white furniture into one, so hey.
Yeah.
That's right. How about the Applied Technology Center for Alamance Pentecom?
Have it for us all.
Right.
Great location.
Thanks, Tom. That's a good suggestion.
$15 million, you can do a lot with that building. A lot less than that, and it's 3 acres of land. Maybe that's an idea.
Wouldn't it be nice to find somebody that wanted it that actually could return it to generating tax revenue?
That would be the best thing.
With your apartment or condo.
Do you want to advertise and see, or
I wouldn't be against putting some feelers out to the real estate community and see if there's some interest there.
We will.
I don't know.
Should come here and take that A-frame off that roof, doctor it up a little bit. Yeah, probably good sale. At least rent.
If the board, and we would probably need a motion from the board to authorize staff to begin advertising for sealed bids and try to go through the process. And again, the board would have the right to accept or reject any and all bids.
Right.
Yes.
So that would probably need to be in a motion.
That I would make that motion that we do that to see what kind of response we get. I don't think we have anything to lose right now.
Can you state the motion, please?
I would make a motion that we put it out for sealed bids to come in on this property as it sits.
And how would the sealed bid process
operate? You put an ad in the paper requesting.
But don't we need that option, though, to reject or?
Well, that would be part of the sealed bid with the option of board approval for the bid.
Right. You pick a day that you're going to open the bids.
Right.
Advertise 30 days.
Right.
And that day comes, you open the bid, and you report it to the board.
Right.
And then we can make that decision at that point in time.
The only cost we would have, we'd probably like to put a sign, a large sign out front. State the advertising and women,
right. I think we. That's my motion to put that up as a sealed bid, coming back to the county with board approval, of course, once they're open, and see what kind of response we get.
I'll second.
Second by Tim. Other discussion or questions? The only thing I'd like to know, Clyde, maybe the next meeting, is what kind of time frame would all that be in? When would the bids go out? How long would they go out?
We can get you that information
that's
tomorrow.
Just pretty standard on that. Yeah, I'm thinking. Yeah.
I think it'd be good.
You have to advertise the notice of the sale at least 30 days before the sale. So we could put something in the paper. If you want to really put some speed on it, we could put it in the paper this week.
Right.
Well, whatever staff thinks on that. Okay, we have a motion and a second. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed?
No.
Thank you. Other report items, Craig?
I do want to mention that the offices will be closed on Monday for Memorial Day. And if you do get the opportunity to go to the Memorial Day celebration that is held in front of the Criminal Courts Building at 11 a.m. on Monday, please do. It is a wonderful job that I think the veterans group does. And been there the last couple of years, and it's a very moving celebration.
Yeah.
I think you're involved in that, aren't you, Sheriff?
And that is all I have.
County Commissioner comments?
I just want to remind everybody it's Motorcycle Awareness Month. So you guys be careful and watch out for motorcyclists as you're driving around. We had a young lady got killed this weekend. And just like everybody to pay attention. Tim, you tell those kids to pay attention to motorcycles. Yep.
Pay attention to us.
That's right. That too.
Thank you, Eddie. Other comments? Bill? Well, again, thanks to each of you for attending this evening and bringing your insight and your interest. Most importantly, we'll stand adjourned.
Thank you for tuning in to the Alamance County Commissioners meeting. Meetings of the Commissioners Board occur at 7 p.m. on the first and third Monday of each month in the Commissioners' Chambers on the second floor of the County Office Building located at 124 West Elm Street in Graham. Changes to the meeting schedule will be posted on the Commissioners' website at www.alamance-nc.com. You can watch the most recent meeting of the County Commissioners on the second and fourth Wednesday of each month on Time Warner's local public access channel beginning at 10 o'clock p.m. You can also watch recordings of the most recent meeting and past meetings by going to our website at www.alamance-nc.com. Please visit our website for more information on watching commissioner meetings online. For technical questions about this meeting's online or television broadcast, please contact our county webmaster at webmaster@alamance-nc.com. Please note that this address is for technical questions only. Questions or comments regarding the content of commissioner meetings may be made to the commissioners themselves. You can find their contact information at the Alamance County website at www.alamance-nc.com. click on the link that says Alamance County Commissioners to visit the Commissioners' website, where you can learn about our Commissioners, read minutes of past meetings, access agendas, and find other information about our Board of Commissioners. You can also send mail correspondence to the County Commissioners by addressing it to the Alamance County Commissioners, 124 West Elm Street, Graham, North Carolina, 27253. Again, thank you for tuning in to the Alamance County Commissioners meeting.